Well, today's message is actually, I'm talking about a guy named Ralph at the homeless ministry. Today's message is actually inspired by something that he said to me. This man was in a wheelchair. Like I said, he was in a car accident. And the way he was in this wheelchair, I'm not so sure that he would ever, unless it's a miracle of God, that he would get out of that wheelchair. He was strong in his Bible. He had a strong faith. And this man obviously knew the Word. And during our conversation, this was after we brought the message, and there was a line of people that I prayed with, like I said, to give their lives to the Lord. Well, he was kind of sitting back, and I talked to him afterwards. And he said something to me that just hit me like a ton of bricks. I never even thought of it. And like I said in the past, you know, when God gives me a sermon, he does it in different ways. Sometimes I'm reading the Bible and he'll give me a sermon. Sometimes it could be at the first of the week and it's just on my heart and I have to get it out. But I definitely know when God shows me the sermon for the next Sunday. Well, yesterday, it was when he said this to me, God spoke to me and said, "That's the name. That's going to be your sermon for tomorrow." I didn't tell him that. I was just sitting back listening to what he had to say. See, God speaks to us through other people also. But we were talking about Jesus going to the cross on his way to Mount Calvary. And he said, you know, even Jesus needed a little bit of help. I thought, wow, I never thought about that. On the way to Mount Calvary, he said, even Jesus needed a little bit of help. See, so many times in our Christian life, we become stubborn in the fact that we just won't allow people to help us. Whatever reason it may be, maybe it's because of stubbornness, maybe it's pride. Maybe it's because we really do want to trust God to get us through it. Whatever the reason is, even Jesus received some help from another man. When you're serving God, you will not always understand what it is that God is having you to do. I can imagine Jesus, the Son of God, coming to this earth and taking on the sin of the world. I mean, surely him being in the flesh, he must have thought a few times, why? Well, he had to have, because he prayed to the Father, if there's any other way, remove this cup from me. If there's any other way for this to happen, please do it. So he had to have thought the same things. But sometimes when God tells you to do something, he calls you to do something, you're not always going to understand why. And as I've said many times in the past, you don't have to understand. Try not to figure it out. Try not to understand it, because we can't. And we see it in Proverbs 3:5. It simply says to trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. So you're not always going to understand why God is having you do something or why you're going through something. You're not always going to understand why it's this path that you're taking. As long as you know that God is directing you, that's all that matters. Because when you trust in the Lord with all of your heart, you know that the bottom line is that God is going to see you through whatever it is you're going through. We don't understand why we go through some of the things that we go through or face some of the things that we face. But when you have faith in God and know who God is, and also not only know who God is, but know who you are in Christ. See, I think sometimes us Christians forget exactly the power that we have within us as a child of God. And when you activate your faith and truly trust in the Lord with all of your heart, you won't care what you're going through, because you know that your God is going to get you through it. With that said, I want to take a look at what Jesus was willing to go through. We're talking about how Jesus was on the way to Mount Calvary when he needed a little bit of help. So when we think about what Jesus truly did, when you think about His willingness to come down from the heavens, a place where there is no pain, no suffering, no death, and yet He came here to face the ultimate pain. I just can't comprehend how the Son of God, Jesus Christ, sitting in the heavens, where there is no pain, no suffering, walking the streets of gold, had everything He could ever need, was willing to come to this earth. I mean, He was walking streets of gold. Now He's walking the streets of cobblestone, you know? He had no pain or suffering in heaven, and now He's going to face the ultimate pain and the ultimate suffering. He left a place where He had everything, and yet He came to a place where He had absolutely nothing. In fact, Jesus, His words were in Matthew 8:20, He said, "The foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay His head." So this shows us how much love that not God the Father had for us by giving us His Son, but also by Jesus Himself willing to come down and face what He had to endure for us. So He comes to this earth willingly to ultimately be crucified for the sin of the world, although He knew no sin. He took on the sin of the world. You know, He's willing to come to this earth. He's willing to take on the sin of the world, although He knew no sin, although He did not deserve any of it. He didn't deserve to be crucified, but He did it for us because of the love that He had for us. And I have a hard time understanding, and then us Christians, we act like, you know, we make big sacrifices whenever we're trying to do what God called us to do. Let me tell you, we don't have a clue of what a true sacrifice is, you know. Just because we're trying to do what God called us to do, and we have to give up a friend or two along the way because they seem to try to pull you back into worldly things, or maybe, you know, they start calling you a Bible thumper or calling you some kind of name to make you feel bad for what you're doing. We call that a true sacrifice. Yes, that's not a sacrifice. I mean, you know, Jesus died on a cross for us. Surely, surely we can serve Him. Now, I have seen, in fact, I just read this morning, you probably saw the first one where the mayor in Houston is trying to gather up all the sermons from some of the pastors there in Houston. Have y'all heard about that? So it's, I guess she's homosexual and that got voted into the mayor, and so she's going after some of the pastors in Houston. And if they don't turn their sermons over, then they get faced with some kind of criminal charge. And because they're, I guess they, now, well, I read just this morning, I was reading, and there's another, I don't know where this state or city is, but I was reading this morning where there's two ordained ministers, and they have a chapel, a wedding chapel, and they do make profit because they do weddings and they charge for it, but they are ordained ministers who are doing this, pastors, two pastors doing this on the side. Well, apparently in 2013, they passed a law that says you cannot discriminate. So the city called these pastors to check, and they said, "Hey, we want to get married, same-sex marriage." And they said, "No, we can't do that." So now they're going after them to take them to court and said, "You have to do this wedding." So, you know, there will be more persecutions. I say right now we don't know what that is right now, but there will come the day when we see a lot more of this. We're getting further and further away from God as a nation, and you can see it starting to happen. And we're going to start seeing, you know, I was just talking not too long ago about how these same-sex marriages, how it's going to affect what the pastors are doing in the church. It is going to try to, and it will. And we saw the first one that I read about this morning. They're already telling them, you have to do these marriages or else you can't, you know, you can't minister. You've got to do it. You're going to face criminal charges. Put them in jail and like $1,000 a day fine or something. So it's coming. And we're going to see more of this. But as far as us making a sacrifice, we really don't know what a sacrifice truly is when we compare it to what Jesus has done. So I want to take a look at these scriptures in Matthew 27, 22 through 43. This is Jesus leading up to going to the cross. And it says, Pilate said unto them, What shall I do with Jesus, which is called Christ? And they all said to him, Let him be crucified. And the governor said, Why, what evil has he done? But they cried out more, saying, Let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but rather that a tumult was made, he took water, washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See you to it. Then answered all the people and said, His blood be on us and on our children. Then released he Barabbas unto them, and when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall, and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers. They stripped him, put on a scarlet robe, and when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head, and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed the knee before him, mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. And they spit upon him, took the reed, and smote him on the head. And after that they had mocked him, they took the robe from him, and put his own clothing on, and then they led him away to be crucified. And then they came across a man named Simon, and this is where it is. Came across this man named Simon, and they compelled him to bear the cross with Jesus. And when they were coming to a place called Golgotha, that is to say a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink mingled with gall. And when they had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him, parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. And sitting down, they watched him there, and set up over his head his accusation that was written, This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and the other on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads, and saying, Thou that destroyest the temple, and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. They have no idea what they're saying. If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross, and then we will believe. He trusted in God. Let him deliver him now, if he will have him, for he said, I am the Son of God. So, you know, we talk about Jesus. He came to this earth. He was willing to face all this pain and all this suffering. He was willing to face all this pain and suffering. Now he's standing before a crowd that's yelling, crucify him. He didn't do anything. All he did was save people. All he did was heal people. All he did was speak the truth. Kind of like in today's world, isn't it? Nobody wants to hear the truth. They want to get rid of it. Well, let's just go start taking all their sermons away. You know? And if they don't want to give up their sermons, we'll take them to court. Really? But, you know, we think we're facing persecution. Jesus is being crucified for the truth that he spoke. They didn't want to hear it back then, just like they don't want to hear it today. But he was willing to come and face it anyways. He was willing to come to this earth and face that pain. When you think about what they did to Jesus, you know, in the commentaries, when you study it out, it says that Jesus was beaten so badly that you would not recognize him as a human being. He was beaten so badly that you would not recognize him as a human being. Can you imagine the cat of nine tails that they beat him with? Taking the flesh from his body. And I don't know about you guys, but I would rather somebody hit me than sit there and spit on me. And they were spitting on him, kicking him, ripping the flesh from his body. And then the humiliation of having all your clothes ripped off in front of everybody and gambling for him and eventually nailed to a Roman cross, you know. And what he was willing to do for the sin of the world is just, that's a sacrifice that he made for us because of his love for us. But what I want to focus on in this is verse 32 as we read, it says that the man named Simon helped him bear his cross. He helped Jesus carry that cross on the way to Mount Calvary. So when we think about what Jesus, the sacrifice that he made for us, imagine the pain, imagine the suffering, the humility, imagine how tired and exhausted that he must have been from the trauma of all this beating. And yet, even the Son of God in the flesh, remember, Jesus was in the flesh just like we are, so he felt pain, he felt loneliness, he felt what it was like to be lonely. Another example of that is, I think of, when Jesus is on the cross and he looks down, you know, he had 12 disciples, but there was only one that was there. Where were the other ones at? You know, where's the other 11 disciples? They were nowhere to be found. And the one that was there was actually his brother. You know, so I wonder if it's like that today. I wonder if Jesus is looking down upon this world and he's saying, where's all the Christians at? You know, I died for them. And yet they can't even go to church. They can't even do the things I've called them to do. I gave my life. I sacrificed for them. Where are they at? What are they doing? Well, they're getting deceived by the enemy is what they're doing. They're not doing exactly the things that God's called them to do. But even the Son of God being in the flesh, he needed a little bit of help. And the man who helped him was Simon. A little bit of help from someone in order to finish carrying out the will of God for his life. When I think of this, I think of a couple of things. Number one, he was the Son of God. I wonder if he really needed that help, or is he trying to teach us something here? I think he's trying to teach us because he was the Son of God. I think he's trying to teach us, Christians, it's okay to take a little bit of help. It's okay to have somebody come in our life and help us along the way. Okay? And then I think about the men on that boat. Remember that big storm that came through and Jesus is asleep in the bottom of that boat? He's down there sleeping. Jesus isn't asleep because he's a lazy God. He's not asleep because he don't care about the people that was on that boat. He's trying to teach us something. He's asleep on the bottom of that boat. See, this storm got so bad that it says that it could have ripped that boat into pieces, into shreds. That's how bad the storm was. It was blowing that boat around. The waves coming up on top of it. And Jesus is asleep in the bottom. Not because he don't care. Not because you know, he's lazy. He's trying to show us he's at peace. When we're going through our storm and we just don't know what in the heck we're going to do, oh my gosh, I'm about to lose it. Jesus says, I'm at peace. Just come to me. I'm at peace. I can handle it. Jesus is not overtaken by fear. Jesus didn't wake up, you know, in that boat and say, oh my gosh, I didn't know that there was a storm. Why didn't you guys tell? He wasn't surprised by anything. He's trying to teach us. No matter what storm you're going through, he's at peace. Now, he did say to the guys, because when they woke him up, they said, Lord, you don't care that we're going to die. You don't care we're going to perish. You don't care. So he said, why is it that you have such little faith? What Jesus would have liked them to do was when that storm arose, what they should have done was say, like we, you know, I say they should have done, but we're the same way. Whenever a storm arises, what they should have done was went to God and pray and say, we're going to put this into your hands, Lord, and then start speaking with authority through Jesus Christ over that storm. Because that's what the Bible tells us to do. Speak to your mountains. Cast your mountains into the sea with the authority of Jesus Christ behind it. But instead, they started questioning God. You know, I wonder if Jesus ever just looks down and says, man, come on, people. Where's the faith at? It must have been real refreshing to have a man like Job, you know. He didn't have to do that because Job just fell on his knees and began to praise God. It must have been real refreshing for God to finally have a person like that. whatever storm you're going through, Jesus is at peace. Jesus will see you through it if you just go to Him in prayer and cast it upon Him. Now, I know that God's will for our life does not include facing this kind of pain and suffering that Jesus went through. However, I do believe that there are a whole lot of Christians out there trying to serve God who are getting tired in the battle. Because we're in a battle, a spiritual warfare. You know, we just had the sermon a month ago or whatever it was about fighting spiritual wickedness. You know, Satan. We had the picture of the statue and all that they're putting at the state capitol of Satan. We're fighting a spiritual warfare, and it can get tiring. We can get weary and weak. Christians who need a little help to cross the finish line in their own race. You know, they're Christians who could use some help in order to complete God's will for their own life. So my question to you today is, are you the one who is needing some help in order to finish God's will in your life? Because God has a job for every one of us. God has a purpose for every life. God has a plan for every person. If you have stepped out in faith to do what God has called you to do, maybe you're the one that's needing a little bit of help. You know, have you gotten to a place in your Christian walk where you're just kind of like, you know, I'm getting tired and these battles are just wearing me out and I need some help. If that's you, then ask yourself, are you willing to accept this help? Or do we deny it? Do we become stubborn and prideful and resist any help that God has tried to bless us with? You know, because we can do that sometimes. When God's trying to bless us with people in our lives to help us, and we're resistant to it, we won't allow it to happen. Because we just want to trust God to get us through it. Well, God's trying to get you through it. Which reminds me of, I guess you can call it a joke. I don't know what you want to call it. But I've heard this where, and you probably heard it too. It's where there's this guy and this flood comes. And it forces this man on his roof. And as the water's coming up, the flood's coming up and he's on his roof, there's a little rat that comes by and they offer to give him a life vest, something that he can swim to safety. He said, here, put this on, you can swim to safety. And he said, no, I want to trust my God to get me out of this. The water continues to rise up to the roof line and a boat comes by. They say, jump in the boat, we'll get you to safety. No, I want to trust my God to get me through this. So the water's all the way to the top of the roof and he's on the very peak of the roof and a helicopter flies by and drops a ladder. And says, climb the ladder, we'll get you to safety. He said, no, I'm going to trust my God to get me through this. Well, the man ends up drowning. And he's standing before God. And he said to God, he said, I was trusting you. Where were you? I was trusting you to get me through this. And God said, I gave you three chances. You know? I gave you three chances. Listen. God is not always going to just, boom, you know? Here's an angel to come down. He's going to use people to bless you, to help you along the way. We've got to learn to quit being so stubborn and put aside our pride and accept the help that God has put before you. You know, the guy on the rooftop, he had three chances to be saved and he just wasn't going to accept. It couldn't, you know, that's not of God. Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was. There was also a point in Paul's life, one of the greatest men in the Bible, that he had to begin to teach another man named Timothy in the ministry. Because in his later years, he needed help. So he began to teach Timothy the ministry. He needed help. The time may come in your Christian life that you will need to accept the fact that you need some help in completing God's will in your own life. Now, if you can honestly say that you're not this person, if you can honestly say in your heart with no doubt, and you can say, you know what? I know I'm in God's will, but right now, I don't feel that way. I feel like I'm doing fine. Then let me ask you a question here. If you know that it's not you that needs the help, are you open to let God use you to help somebody else? See? Will you allow God to let you be a Simon in somebody else's life? Maybe you don't need the help. Maybe you're right in the middle of God's will in your life. You're moving forward. You're doing what God's called you to do. And you don't need the help right now, but the day could come real soon. And maybe this message is to prepare you for that day. To know, you know what? Sometimes you're going to need a little bit of help. And it's okay. It's okay to take help from other men, other women, as long as they're brothers and sisters in the Lord. Has God laid on your heart to help someone carry out their own mission for God? Has He laid on your heart to help someone? And you know, whether it's this ministry or not, you know, I'm not talking about this ministry in particular, I'm just talking about in general. Has God laid on your heart to help someone? That's like, this donation room over here. We get so many donations, it's overwhelming. And it takes all of us in the church to make it work. People folding clothes, getting boxes ready, taking it to the city. All of us going out telling people, hey, this is what we're doing. If you have any extra clothes, you know, bringing those clothes in. It takes a lot of people to make all this work. But maybe it's not this ministry. Maybe even though you're part of this church and part of this ministry, maybe God's laying on your heart to help this person over here. And when I think of Daniel at work, when I think of this, see, Daniel has a church home that he's faithful to. Daniel has a place to go on Sundays and Wednesdays. See, he's got a church. But it's like he told me, that doesn't stop him from helping us do what God's called us to do. So you can be part of this ministry and be busy right here in this church. But if God puts on your heart to help somebody else, you know, you can, just like Daniel's helping us. He goes, you know, when he can, he goes out on Saturdays and helps with the homeless, or, you know, he got the signs for us to put up. He gives to our church every month, so he's a blessing to us. And he's excited about what he sees us doing in the ministry, and he wants to be part of it, although he's already got a church home in the city. So, has God laid on your heart to help someone? Is God trying to use you as a Simon in somebody's ministry? We must be willing to let God use us in helping out someone that God has directed us to, but are we doing it? And like I said earlier, haven't you gotten to a place in your spiritual life that you think that you just feel like you might give up? Haven't you in your spiritual life ever gotten to a place where you think, you know what, I just don't know if I can do this anymore. These battles are wearing me out. I'm getting tired. You know, you start to question things. You start to say things like, you know, am I even making a difference? Am I even reaching out and touching anybody? And you start to, you know, you get tired of all the battles. You get tired of all the fights. You get tired of all the discouragement, all the promises that never follow through. You get tired. You just get tired. Haven't you ever got like that in your spiritual life? Well, see, we don't always know what that other person is thinking. We don't always know what that other person has got going on the inside. On the outside, they might look fine. You know, they might look like they're strong men. They're doing things for God. They're strong. They're tough. They're spiritually. Sometimes we think things like, I wish I could be more like that. But you know what? On the inside, they might be thinking, is it worth it? Am I even making a dent? Am I even helping anybody? Is anybody paying attention? See, we don't know who those people are. But God does. God does. God knows our heart. He knows when we struggle like that. He knows what we're thinking. And if God directs you to help someone out, there's a reason for it. If God directs you to help someone out in their ministry, that's because God has a purpose for it. He has a reason for it. And we don't know what that reason is. We just know that, hey, God laid on my heart to do this thing. You know, to help you or to help them or whatever it might be. But there's a reason why God laid that on your heart. So today, as we look at the scriptures, we can see that even Jesus needed a little bit of help. And it's okay. It's okay. Simon was there to help bear that cross. Has God put a Simon in your life to help you carry your cross? Have you accepted his help? Or has God called you to be a Simon to help another person bear their cross in their life? Because either way, all that matters is that you are obedient to God. Listen, all we have to do is be obedient to God. It's just like Proverbs 3:5 says, just trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. As long as we do that, I'm telling you, God will open doors, God will bless, God will take care of everything, God will. And if God has called you to do something or laid on your heart to do something, I promise you that God is going to put people in your life that's going to, and not only people, but resources. He's going to give you the wisdom, he's going to give you the knowledge, he's going to give you everything that you need to be successful in whatever it is that he called you to do. God is not going to call you to do something and you are doing it 100% only to fail. That's not who God is. But God will bring people in your life. He will bring a Simon in your life whenever you need that help. So with that said, I want to ask that you bow your heads and close your eyes. I want to pray with those who are watching on the online ministry. If you're watching today and you've never accepted Christ as your personal Savior, that's your first step. That's your first step of finding peace and joy and happiness in your life. And if you'll follow me in this simple prayer, Father, I come to you today. I know that you died for the sin of the world. I know that you arose on the third day. And today, I ask that you come into my heart to be my personal Savior, to lead and guide me from this day forth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And the Bible says if you prayed that simple prayer, that you've been born again. And if you'll contact us, we'll help you find a church in your area.